Recorded Books and RB Digital present Outside the Box, How Globalization Changed from Moving Stuff to Spreading Ideas by Marc Levinson, narrated by L.J. Ganser. Introduction. On August 16, 2006, at 5:30 in the afternoon, five tugboats dragged Emma Maersk from the Odense Steel Shipyard and towed her backward to the sea. Whether new or old, ships generally sail forward, not backward. But there was nothing typical about Emma Maersk. The length of four soccer fields, her keel nearly 100 feet below her deck, the light blue vessel was so enormous she could barely escape the confines of the shallow Odense fjord. As she passed through the gabet, the narrow gap between the fjord and the deeper waters beyond, the thousands of Danes lining the beaches were treated to an extraordinary sight. On her launch day, because Emma carried neither cargo nor fuel, she rode high in the water, partially exposing her white underside and showing off the massive bronze propeller that would normally turn silently beneath the waves. It was, as everyone knew from news reports, by far the largest propeller ever cast. Emma Maersk was a bet on globalization. Owned by Maersk Line, part of a venerable Danish conglomerate, she dwarfed every vessel that had preceded her in the 50-year history of container shipping. Save for a handful of oil supertankers, there had never been a ship so large. Emma and the seven similar ships that were to follow cost $154 million apiece, much more than any container ship had cost before, and the price seemed a bargain. If the new vessels were loaded to capacity, they would be able to transport the world's trade more cheaply than any other ships afloat. As the world economy expanded and long-distance trade increased with it, Maersk Line's leaders expected that cost advantage would enable their company to capture a growing share. Container ships are the workhorses of globalization, carrying steel boxes stuffed with everything from washing machines to waste paper, vast distances on regular schedules, meshing with trucks, trains, and barges to serve cities miles inland. International cargo that is time-sensitive or highly valuable, diamonds, disk drives, usually flies across the oceans. But almost everything else churned out by factories and much that comes from farms is packed into standard containers 40 feet long and 8 feet across. In the final decades of the 20th century, containers all but erased transportation costs as a factor in decisions about where to make things, where to grow things, and how to move goods to customers. They helped reshape world trade, making it feasible to combine parts from a dozen countries into a finished car and delivering wine from Australia to California, a distance of 7,000 miles for perhaps 15 U.S. cents a bottle. They lay behind the startling transformation of China into the world's largest manufacturing nation, and behind the desolation of long-standing manufacturing centers from Detroit to Dortmund, as distinct national markets, protected by high transportation costs, merged into a nearly seamless global one. Since the first container ship steamed from Newark to Houston in 1956, each generation of vessels had been larger and more cost-effective than its predecessors. Emma and her sister ships were commissioned in the expectation that this trend would continue, making it even easier for families to enjoy fresh strawberries in wintertime and enabling manufacturers to weld longer, more complex supply chains, linking factories and distribution centers thousands of miles apart. Dozens of even larger ships would soon follow in Emma's wake, some able to carry more cargo than 11,000 over-the-road trucks. But just as a race to build monumental skyscrapers often heralds an economy poised for a correction, the Empire State Building in New York, planned in the late 1920s to be the world's tallest building, sat largely empty through the Great Depression of the 1930s, so the construction of ships too big to call at most of the world's ports was an early indicator of excessive exuberance. Unremarked at the time of Emma Maersk's launch, the era of ceaseless growth in goods trade was about to draw to a close. Those who assumed that globalization would stay on the course it had followed since the aftermath of World War II would pay a steep price. Globalization is not a recent concept. The word seems to have made its first appearance in Belgium in 1929. Physician and educator J.O. de Croly used globalization to refer to a young child's developing attention to the broader world rather than itself alone. Over time, the term has had many other meanings. The idea that giant companies can sell the same product everywhere rather than different models in each country. The transmission of ideas from one country to another. The flag-waving enthusiasm of Americans and Kenyans and Chinese for English soccer teams led by non-British stars. The worldwide diffusion of religions is a form of globalization, as are the spread of disease and the large-scale migration of people in search of personal safety, political or social freedom, or greater economic opportunity. So, of course, is the increasing intensity of economic exchange across international frontiers. The world was in some ways highly globalized long ago. As the historians Jürgen Osterhammel and Niels P. Patterson put it, in a certain sense, the Americanization of Germany did not begin in 1945, but rather in the 18th century with the introduction of the potato. But globalization, as that term is used today, erupted with the birth of industrial capitalism in the 19th century, as Europe's colonial powers spun commercial webs across Africa and Asia, protecting their interests with armies, navies, and professional corps of colonial civil servants. Erstwhile manufacturing centers, notably India, were unable to match the higher productivity of European factories. And as their textiles became uncompetitive with foreign products, they sank into the role of commodity exporters. During this first globalization, international lending was routine, and in many countries, exports and imports accounted for large shares of economic activity. Migrants crossed borders by the tens of millions, and motifs from China and Tahiti found their way into European art. The world seemed to have become so interconnected that war was impossible, until the eruption of World War I in August 1914 brought the first globalization to an abrupt end. The process of globalization paused from 1914 until roughly 1947, through two world wars, numerous regional wars, and a Great Depression. While multinational corporations expanded during those years, many of the financial, commercial, and human links across borders eroded. In some quarters, this retreat was welcomed. In 1943, the U.S. Congresswoman Clare Booth Luce criticized Vice President Henry Wallace, who prided himself on his global perspective, for spouting globaloney. After much criticism, Luce abandoned the term in favor of global nonsense. But in the wake of her coinage, words such as globalistic, globalitis, and globalism made their way into the American vocabulary, being employed to disparage immigration, foreign trade, and even proposals for international cooperation. Globalization began anew in the late 1940s, after the Allied victory in World War II. This development was supported by a less rigid system of exchange rates and a concerted effort to lower barriers to trade in raw materials and manufactured goods. The result was a quarter century of robust economic growth in all the world's rich economies and many of the poor ones. Despite the economic crises of the 1970s, trade in manufactured goods, measured by the volume of goods traded, was roughly 15 times as high in 1986 as it had been in 1950. With prices soaring, the oil market became thoroughly global as supertankers, more properly known as ultra-large crude carriers, delivered millions of barrels of petroleum on a single voyage from the Persian Gulf to refineries in Europe, Japan, and North America. As oil-exporting countries deposited their surging receipts into banks in London, New York, and Tokyo, the financial markets lent generously to developing country governments and helped multinational corporations plant their flags around the world. Yet this second globalization, like the first globalization before it, was not truly global. Companies aggressively planted their flags abroad, but their identities were inextricably linked to their home countries, where almost all their top managers were born and bred. While foreign investment soared, most of it took place among a handful of wealthy nations, and so did most foreign trade. Less affluent countries, many of which fell deeply into debt, participated only tangentially, mainly by borrowing from rich country investors and by exporting raw commodities, like oil and coffee. Indeed, the harshest critiques of globalization during the four decades between 1947 and 1986 came largely from those who thought freer economic exchange enabled rich countries to exploit poor ones. Immigration was often deemed exploitative as well, as rich countries stood accused of causing a brain drain by enticing nurses and teachers to emigrate from poorer lands. Countries aspiring to overcome poverty and backwardness, critics claimed, would be better off doing more for themselves. Many large and populous countries, including China, India, and the Soviet Union, embraced autarky, tightly controlling trade, investment, migration, tourism, scientific exchange, religious ideas, and other sorts of international links their rulers thought dangerous. The ascent of free market ideologies in the wealthier economies, emblemized by Margaret Thatcher's election to lead Great Britain in 1979, followed by Ronald Reagan's election as U.S. president in 1980, opened the way to new economic relationships. When Honda Motor Company opened the first Japanese-owned auto assembly plant in the United States in 1982, it shocked competitors with its ability to organize the timely delivery of engines and transmissions across thousands of miles of sea and land. By the late 1980s, such long-distance supply chains had become routine as a third globalization emerged. The nature of international trade changed dramatically as it became practical for a retailer or manufacturer to have components designed in one country, made in another, and combined to finished products elsewhere still, moving the partially finished goods from place to place with little regard for national boundaries. The link between physical location and nationality was erased. When a Massachusetts-based manufacturer of industrial abrasives with plants in 27 countries could be owned by a Paris-based corporation that counted Dutch pension funds, British investment trusts, and Middle Eastern governments among its major shareholders? Who was to say whether the resulting entity was French, American, or just international? The fall of communism in 1989 seemed to signal the final victory of capitalism, as countries that had long been suspicious of market forces suddenly welcomed them. International trade grew nearly three times as fast as the world economy. Once more, there were objections aplenty about exploitation. Only now, instead of hurting workers in poor countries, globalization was said to devastate workers in rich countries. In 1994, Sir James Goldsmith, a wealthy British financier and scion of a thoroughly international family, criticized open borders in a bestseller called The Trap. Vivian Forrester, a French essayist, decried l'horreur économique in 1996. 3 years later, as British sociologist Anthony Giddens warned of a runaway world, tens of thousands of demonstrators, some anti-capitalist, some environmentalist, some concerned about vanishing jobs, some prepared for a rumble, took to the streets of Seattle to protest a conclave of trade ministers from around the world. Economists' nearly unanimous argument that freer exchange would make the world more prosperous gained little traction, and the eagerness of poorer countries to open themselves to the world economy was largely ignored. When two British journalists published a book about globalization in 2000, their title, A Future Perfect, rang out of tune. World trade in manufactured goods rose 120% in the span of just 7 years, from 2001 to 2008, as manufacturing surged in China, while during those same 7 years, one in eight manufacturing jobs in Canada and the United States, and one in four in Great Britain, disappeared. It was hard not to draw a connection. The flight to factory jobs was followed by jobs in technology and service industries. As office buildings everywhere were cabled to the internet, a new industry called business process outsourcing took hold. Companies in Frankfurt and Paris moved their accounting work to lower-wage cities, such as Warsaw and Prague, and agents in Manila answered customer service calls for North American banks. By 2003, 285 of the 500 largest U.S. companies were sending office work to India. Thousands of white-collar jobs are going overseas, a U.S. congressman warned in 2004, citing incontrovertible evidence that the U.S. is on the verge of adopting the economics of third-world nations. The retreat of the third globalization began unrecognized, not long after Emma Maersk took to the seas. In the summer of 2008, amid a global financial crisis, the volume of international trade collapsed. Cross-border investments in business, which had tripled over the previous 5 years, dried up just as suddenly. These trends were unhappy, but not surprising. In times past, trade and investment had ebbed during recessions only to rise afterward, and this pattern seemed likely to play out once again. But this time, as the world economy crept back from the depths in 2010, trade and investment did not rebound as they always had. The changes revealed by economic statistics and shipping data were gradually confirmed by the actions of international firms, which began retracting their supply chains and slimming down their foreign operations. Although angry opposition to globalization remained, now fueled mainly by anti-immigrant fervor in the United States and Europe, globalization itself was changing. By the time U.S. presidential candidate Donald Trump inveighed against radical globalization and the disenfranchisement of working people in 2016, and the French politician Marine Le Pen criticized the rampant globalization that is endangering our civilization a few months later, these actions and reactions, this Sturm und Drang, pertained to an era that was already drawing to a close. When the viral disease labeled COVID-19 began to spread from Wuhan, China, in late 2019, leading to business shutdowns and household quarantines from Norway to New Zealand, and disrupting commerce and travel on a global scale, the transformation of the third globalization into a very different set of international relationships was already well underway. Many trees have been felled in the effort to praise, condemn, or simply quantify globalization. This book does none of the above. It asserts that globalization, as it has developed over two centuries, is far from an inevitable consequence of capitalism. Globalization has transformed itself repeatedly over two centuries in response to technological change, demographic pressure, entrepreneurial ambition, and governmental action. Someone speaking of globalization in 2020 was discussing an altogether different subject from globalization in 1980, much less in 1890. It treats the third globalization, the quarter century or so between the late 1980s and the early 2010s, as a distinct stage in the world's economic history, a stage unlike what came before and what is likely to come after. It emphasizes the roles of transportation, communications, and information technology in enabling firms to organize their businesses around long-distance value chains, a fundamentally different type of economic relationship from any that existed before. I have been writing about globalization as a journalist, economist, and historian for more years than I am eager to admit. My book, The Box, How the Shipping Container Made the World Smaller and the World Economy Bigger, showed how a seemingly simple innovation was the key to the lengthy supply chains that became the hallmark of globalization in the late 1980s. In an extraordinary time, the end of the post-war boom and the return of the ordinary economy, I examined how governments responded to the global economic slowdown that began around 1973 by deregulating entire sectors of their economies and welcoming market forces, making it easier for firms to organize their businesses across national boundaries. Outside the Box builds on that earlier work, but also draws on new archival research, interviews, and a robust academic literature to explain why, in the early 21st century, globalization developed in ways that were counterproductive for many of the countries and many of the firms that eagerly embraced it. This historical perspective explains why, notwithstanding intense chatter about the impending end of globalization, I think globalization is far from dead. Rather, as it has on several past occasions, globalization is entering a new phase, one in which the world economy will still be bound closely together, but in ways different from what the experience of recent decades has taught us to expect. Understanding globalization's past may shed light upon its future, a future that will almost certainly not involve a return to the days when countries sought to prosper by fencing themselves off from their neighbors. By and large, globalization has been good for the world. It has brought hundreds of millions out of dire poverty, turning the days when Americans told their children to eat their vegetables because people were starving in China into a distant memory. Consumers have gained access to an unimagined selection of products at very low cost, and some of the most isolated places on Earth were linked to the world economy thanks to technologies that once would have passed them by. By allowing firms to specialize in their most productive activities at a global scale while relying on outside suppliers to meet their other needs, globalization has generated massive productivity improvements that have created immense wealth. International conflicts have not gone away, but they have been tempered by the fact that almost every country's prosperity depends more on its neighbors than ever before. When, as the coronavirus spread, hospitals around the world urgently sought ventilators to help critically ill patients breathe, efforts to build more were slowed by the need to acquire parts from a dozen countries, but also aided by a vibrant global market in which valves, tubes, and motor parts were to be had. But globalization has not been an unalloyed blessing. The rapid industrialization of countries that were only recently quite poor, especially in Asia, was matched by the brutal deindustrialization of communities across Europe, North America, and Japan. While the distribution of income among countries has become more equitable, inequality within individual countries has increased. People with access to capital have reaped great rewards from new opportunities, but workers reliant on wages often have found themselves competing directly with low-paid labor in distant places, and small towns have atrophied as big cities capture a disproportionate share of the growth. In the process, governments have lost much of their control over their economies. Minimum wage laws and social protections became harder to enforce once firms could easily circumvent them by moving, or threatening to move, a particular activity abroad. The constant possibility of corporate relocation created an international contest to lower taxes on business, starving governments of the revenues to fund education and social programs intended to help workers cope with a world in which employment had become less stable. Over time, a relatively small number of firms came to dominate entire industries, a development that threatens to raise prices, retard innovation, and make incomes even more unequal. The economic strains of globalization undermined the structures erected over decades to promote international cooperation, creating new uncertainties as nationalist narratives supplanted global ones. Through two centuries of history, globalization has not proceeded in a straight line. Wars and recessions have interrupted the flow of trade, investment, and migration, and individual countries have chosen to sever themselves from the world economy for extended periods. Russia, from its 1917 revolution to the late 1980s. China, for three decades after the Communist Party took power in 1949. Against this background, claims that peak globalization is past, or that a globalized world economy is dissolving into regional blocks, seem rather premature. Globalization is not going away. But by the second decade of the 21st century, as giant container ships sailed half-empty around the world, it was taking on a very different form. The flow of metal boxes was its past. In the next stage of economic development, it would be the flow of ideas and services that would bind the world's economies more tightly together. Part 1. Coming Together. Chapter 1. Global Dreams. In 1764, a trader named Peter Hosenclaver, fresh off the boat from London, embarked on an extraordinary venture in the mountain fastness of northern New Jersey. Hosenclaver was a man of the world, a globalist by any measure. Born in the German Rhineland in 1716, he seems to have been fluent in German, French, Spanish, and English. In his youth, he wielded a hammer in a steel mill, purchased wool on behalf of German textile plants, and then sold their textiles as far afield as Russia and France. Later, he built trading houses in Portugal and Spain and advised King Frederick the Great on industrializing Prussia. In 1763, a successful and wealthy man, he moved to London, the center of a burgeoning transatlantic empire. Payment of £70 sterling induced Parliament to grant him British citizenship, and with it, the right to invest in the colonies. Then he set out to fulfill an entrepreneurial dream, creating a partnership to supply the Royal Navy's dockyards, the world's largest industrial enterprise, with iron forged in America. Neither Hosenclaver nor his partners had ever visited America. On a map, the iron mines they acquired in New Jersey Colony must have seemed ideal, located just 20 or 30 miles from the bustling port at New York. But as Hosenclaver discovered after he finally crossed the Atlantic, the mines were dug into rocky, heavily forested hillsides in a region of valleys so steep and isolated that settlers had steered clear. The ore, a mass of dirt, stones, and iron, had to be extracted with picks and shovels, then loaded aboard ox carts and hauled miles to ironworks near streams powerful enough to turn water wheels. There, stamping mills crushed the ore, blast furnaces separated the iron from worthless tailings, and workers toiling in the immense heat of a hearth or a furnace melted off the iron and pounded it into bars, 14 feet long and 2 inches on a side. Some of the wrought iron bars were melted down again so that fragments of charcoal could be hammered into the liquid iron, making carbon steel. Delivered to nearby villages, the iron and steel bars were useful only to blacksmiths, shaping horseshoes and fire irons. Real profits would come from transporting the bars to the dockyards in England. Unlike most international traders of his day, who found buyers for foreign goods only after the goods arrived, Hosenclaver envisioned a long-distance supply chain, reliably furnishing the Royal Navy with metal vital for building warships. As side benefits, Britain's New Jersey colony would prosper, and Hosenclaver himself might be admitted to England's economic elite. The Ramapo Mountains, though, had no roads or bridges over which to transport ore from mines to mills. Hosenclaver's partnership, the American Company, had to build them itself. English colonists preferred farming to the dangerous, unpleasant work of making iron and steel in such a remote place. At great expense, the American Company imported experienced stonemasons and ironworkers from Germany, paying their passage in return for promised years of service. The company tapped its investors back in England to acquire 34 square miles of forest to meet the endless need for timber, which would be made into charcoal to fuel the blast furnaces and turn iron into steel. Then it tapped them again to build dams, reservoirs, and canals to keep the water wheels turning. The primitive state of transportation plagued the entire venture. As the forests were cut, the distance from each mill to the nearest remaining stand of trees increased year by year, requiring more roads and more oxen to get timber to the mills. The finished bars had to be carted away from the mills in the same way the ore was brought in, one wagon load at a time. In the winter months, the canals and rivers froze up, and the roads became impassable. "The American iron turns out so dear," Ozenclaver lamented. Ocean shipping was unreliable, and there was no telling when a consignment would reach the Royal Dockyards at Deptford and Portsmouth. The Royal Navy apparently distrusted this erratic transatlantic supply line, for the American company earned no profits and paid no dividends. The London partners soon ran out of patience. In 1768, the fourth year of operation, they ordered the ironworks closed. Ozenclaver was held responsible for the partnership's debts, barely avoiding debtor's prison. When the mines reopened, they sold iron only nearby. The notion of a long-distance industrial supply chain already beckoned, but the developments that made it practical were yet to come. Goods have traveled vast distances since the earliest days of human civilization. 4,000 years ago, the Assyrians ranged hundreds of miles to establish trading colonies in what is now Turkey. Caravans laden with incense began trekking across Arabia once the dromedary was domesticated around 1000 BC. And Socotra, a tiny island off the coast of Yemen, became a hub for trade between India and Rome a millennium later. Another 1,000 years on, at the start of the 11th century, when Norse adventurers reached North America, they must have been disappointed at the lack of opportunities for trade. Marco Polo, his father, and his uncle had better luck when they set off from Venice on their famed journey along the Silk Road to China in 1271. The transatlantic slave trade, which began in the early 1500s, grew into a large and sophisticated business after 1750, with English merchants exporting guns, kettles, cloth, and shoes to their own trading posts on the coast of Africa, exchanging these wares for slaves, selling the slaves in the Americas, and filling their ships with sugar and tobacco for the return trip to England. The African slave trade was extremely profitable and thoroughly global, forcibly transporting an estimated 12.5 million enslaved people on at least 36,000 transatlantic voyages and another 500,000 slaves shipped by sea within the Americas. These exchanges among distant peoples involved more than trade, goods, and slaves. They involved disease. The Black Death swept out of China in 1334, reached the Black Sea in 1346, and within 7 years, killed perhaps 48 million of Europe's 80 million people. They involved ideas. Buddhism was imported from India into China 2,000 years ago. Islam, founded in Arabia around 610, reached Spain by 713. And in the 1540s, Portuguese priests brought Christian ideas to Japan. They involved economic dislocation. Starting around the 1530s, the influx of silver from Spain's new American colonies fed inflation in Europe for 150 years, an event so disruptive that historians know it as the Price Revolution. And they certainly involved the projection of political power, with country after country using trade as a means to expand its dominions with wealth and tax revenue extracted from colonies or vassal states. In the current day, a casual tourist trip to Genoa, Amsterdam, or Istanbul, each a leading center of international commerce in its time, reveals that the exchange of people and goods created enormous wealth long before the age of computers and container ships. The fruits of that exchange are visible as well in the Persian rugs and Chinese porcelains that decorate chateaus and country houses across Europe. Yet these impressions also illustrate why economic relationships before the Industrial Revolution of the 1800s were a far cry from globalization as we understand that term today. The famed Hanseatic League, a commercial alliance of cities in northern Germany, monopolized trade around the Baltic Sea for 3 centuries until the late 1400s. But while this trade brought great prosperity to cities like Lübeck and Hamburg, it was tiny by modern standards. All the ships owned by Hanseatic merchants combined carried less cargo in a year than a single mid-sized 21st century container ship. Well after the Hansa faded into history, Long-distance trade still involved mostly luxury goods, slaves, or essential commodities, such as wheat imported following a poor harvest, in order to avert food riots. As recently as the turn of the 19th century, the average European family was unlikely to possess imported goods beyond a sachet of sugar and the occasional coin stamped from silver. Imports of tea, one of the most widely traded commodities of the era, came to just a couple of ounces per person per year. China, probably the world's largest economy at the time, imported mainly silver bars and black pepper. India and Japan seemed to have imported little of anything. In most societies, the international economy was of little consequence. Trade mattered greatly to merchants dealing in exports and imports. To sailors, carters, and packers who handled goods in transit, to artisans who made glass, fabrics, or other valuable goods for export, to workers forcibly conscripted to raise cotton or mine silver, and to rulers who saw trade as one more opportunity to levy taxes. In numerous European cities, on the other hand, guilds controlled the production of many goods from the 11th century into the 1700s or 1800s, and blocking import competition enabled them to keep prices for their members' products high. In almost all countries, the vast majority of families lived on the land and on the margins of the cash economy, and to them, the world mattered little. One indicator that the level of economic exchange was quite small: as late as 1820, the total carrying capacity of all the world's ships was around 5.9 million metric tons. The corresponding figure in 2018 was 322 times higher, and those ships, traveling much faster, were likely to complete many more voyages in a single year. Why was foreign trade so modest in pre-modern times? Mainly because trading was slow and expensive. When Venetian galleys started to ply the Mediterranean around 1300, each carried roughly 115 metric tons of cargo, approximately the contents of 8 average containers aboard a modern ocean-going ship. Although some galleys were 40 meters long, they were propelled by oarsmen as well as wind power, and feeding and housing the oarsmen took up a considerable part of their capacity. Shipboard space was so scarce that the vessels were permitted to carry only spices, silks, and other precious merchandise. Less valuable products were not traded. 2 centuries later, Venice used larger ships to import bulky commodities such as cotton and wheat from Syria, and to transport barrels of wine from Crete, a Venetian possession, all the way to England. This involved impressive feats of organization, but surprisingly little cargo. The total capacity of the 107 merchant ships sailing for Venice in 1499 was less than 26,000 tons of freight and people. In 2020, a single vessel could carry several times as much. A few years later, Portugal displaced Venice as the world's greatest maritime power by sailing directly between India and Europe, circumventing the middlemen who handled costly land transport across Iraq or Egypt on the way to the Mediterranean. Between 1500 and 1600, though, just 7 Portuguese merchant ships, accompanied by armed caravels or galleons for protection, made the 6-month voyage in the average year. All told, perhaps 5,000 metric tons of cargo moved in Portugal's India trade each year, less than fits aboard 1 modern freight train crossing the North American plains. Admittedly, Portugal's population was barely 1 million at the time, but even so, the small volume of its famed Asian trade is noteworthy. Portugal grew wealthy trading the pepper and other spices the fleet brought home, but for want of space, its ships on the Asia route carried almost nothing else. While bigger ships later crisscrossed the oceans, freight rates remained high enough that bulky or inexpensive goods were not worth transporting. Gold and silver were among the most widely traded commodities because they were highly valuable relative to their weight and volume. Even in the late 1600s, when textile trade began to grow strongly, The products concerned were mainly high-quality Indian cottons exported to Europe and China, and Chinese silks for wealthy European and Japanese buyers. The English weavers who blamed Indian cottons for destroying their livelihoods as early as the 1660s wore scratchy woolens and rough cotton clothing woven domestically, precisely because there were no imported fabrics they could afford. Trading internationally was even costlier over land than across the seas. Freight moved by the wagon load, where roads were good, but in 17th century England, as economic historian Dan Bogart observed, pack horses were the superior technology on bad roads. The same was true in most other countries. Roads broad enough to accommodate wagons and firm enough to survive downpours were expensive to build and maintain. They existed only where there was enough traffic to justify private investment in turnpikes, barricaded by toll gates, where local citizens could be conscripted for road building, or where military needs led the government to pay the cost. In 1800, after turnpikes had begun to ease travel between English cities, the cost of shipping a ton of freight just 1 mile by road equaled a farm laborer's wage for a full day's work. Transport was dear because while roads improved over time, the technology of horse-drawn wagons did not. Shipping by water, even along very circuitous routes, was almost always cheaper than shipping by land. But towns not on navigable waterways faced oppressive costs. China had faced up to this problem centuries earlier by constructing a wide-ranging network of canals. But it would be the early 1800s before canal systems spread widely within Europe, and even later in North America. The ubiquitous role of middlemen added to the cost of trade. Manufacturing migrated to rural areas, where costs were lower than in crowded cities, and farmers had ample free time in the winter to tend hearths and looms. But most goods were produced by very small workshops. In Venice, a law from 1497, not always observed, prohibited a silk manufacturer from employing more than 6 weavers. 2 centuries later, the 18 textile establishments in Clermont-de-l'Odève, in the south of France, had only 29 looms among them. Carriage making in New England was the work of small shops and independent craftsmen, even in the late 1830s. A factory with 100 workers proved too large to manage profitably. Manufacturers operating at this minuscule scale had no hope of exporting on their own. At best, they could supply a trader in the nearest village, who could sell the goods onward to a merchant in a larger town, who might know a merchant in a port city who consolidated shipments for export. Each dealer, of course, collected a commission that added to the price charged to customers abroad. Taxes had impeded foreign trade since the days when Greek city-states assessed a 2% duty on imports and exports. In 1203, King John of England, his treasury drained by war in France, created the first customs service, staffed by agents who required merchants to pay 1/15th of the value of imports or exports to collectors at each port. In many parts of Europe, local rulers and religious officials collected tolls each time freight crossed a river or entered a town. A Swiss trader in the late 1500s, when Germany was still a collection of duchies, counties, principalities, and independent city-states, reported paying 31 tolls between Basel and Cologne, and his descendants in 1765 would have faced duties imposed at almost 500 locations in Bavaria alone. For more than 2 centuries, starting in 1635, Japan allowed European merchants to trade only in one place, Chinese merchants in one other. While this was intended to curtail the spread of foreign ideas, it also facilitated the collection of import taxes. China put a 20% duty on all imports in 1685, and in 1757, it required that all foreign trade pass through the customs office at the southern port of Guangzhou. Whether the trader paid those levies or went to extra expense to evade them, tolls and duties added to importers' bills. And then there was the matter of reliability. Stagecoaches usually ran on schedules, Ocean-going ships did not. Sailing vessels typically cruised from port to port, searching for cargo, and headed overseas only when fully loaded. Severe storms, pirates, and hostile navies frequently damaged their cargo in transit. Inland journeys could be hazardous for traders, as well as the freight they carried, owing to rapacious governments as much as to robbers. Along the Loire River in France, the poor sailors are often compelled, in addition, to make presents to the toll officials, or the latter otherwise delay them as long as they please, one local official complained in 1701. During the Napoleonic Wars of the early 1800s, the British sought to block all sea trade with France. The French forbade their European client states to trade with Britain, and the United States cast a pox on both houses, banning Americans from trading with the warring parties, and in the process, throwing its own economy into depression. Whatever the circumstances, no importer anywhere could count on goods arriving on a particular day or in a particular month, or at all. Market conditions in the importing country could be quite different than anticipated when the goods were shipped months or years before, destroying expected profits. Trading anything that could not be stored indefinitely was foolhardy. The economic orthodoxy that had reigned for centuries held that importing raw materials and exporting finished goods was the way to create wealth. In the 1700s, this idea became known as mercantilism, but long before that, Jean-Baptiste Colbert, finance minister to King Louis XIV of France, effectively translated mercantilism into law. In 1664, Colbert imposed a uniform import tariff across all of France, in place of the disparate tariffs in effect in different regions. 3 years later, he hiked duties on stockings, wool cloth, and other products that competed with French-made goods. Other countries, including England and the Netherlands, responded in kind. British manufacturing flourished thanks to high tariffs, and by the late 1700s, textile mills and potteries established to serve the protected British market were also exporting aggressively. Mercantilists saw international commerce as a competition with winners and losers. If a country exported more than it imported, it was victorious. If its trade was in deficit, it had met defeat. This way of thinking was not entirely irrational. The world economy, by and large, ran on silver. An importer generally had to pay for its purchases in silver. An exporter received silver in return. If a country consistently imported more than it exported, its stockpile of the precious metal would melt away, limiting its ability to import in the future and to buy armaments and hire soldiers in case of war. A consistent trade surplus, in contrast, would allow the country to build up its silver wealth. By those lights, Colbert's tariff increases were a great success because France's trade went from deficit to surplus. Never mind that French nobles faced higher bills for foreign-made silk stockings and feathered hats. When Chinese Emperor Qianlong wrote to Britain's King George III in 1793 to say, "I have no use for your country's manufacturers," he had more on his mind than the corrupting effects of foreign fashions. He knew that the British were much more eager to sell than to buy. By mercantilist lights, wealth came from making things and exporting them. It followed that the only goods a country should import were those it did not make. Englishmen would have agreed unanimously that bringing in tea from India and sugar from Barbados made their country better off. But importing goods that competed with domestic products was to be avoided. The purposes of colonies in this scheme were to furnish raw materials and precious metals to the mother country, buy its manufacturers, and provide it with tax revenue. The Wool Act of 1699, for example, protected British textile makers by allowing Irish wool to be exported only to England and Wales, guaranteeing manufacturers a steady supply of raw material, while barring colonists in North America from shipping woolen and linen yarn and cloth outside their own colony. Lord Cornbury, the British governor of New York, fully understood this purpose, advising London in 1705, "These colonies ought to be kept entirely dependent upon and subservient to England, and that can never be if they are suffered to go on in the notions they have that as they are Englishmen, so they may set up their same manufacturers here as people may do in England. Authorities of France, Spain, and every other colonial power would have said something similar. Little had changed 60 years later in Peter Hosenclaver's day. Mercantilism shaped the American company's brief existence. The partnership existed only because Parliament granted Hosenclaver British citizenship. As a Prussian citizen, his investment would not have been permitted because, by mercantilist lights, any profit he extracted would have diminished British wealth. The American company could not have exported its iron and steel bars from New Jersey colony had not Parliament, aware that British iron makers were desperately short of charcoal after depleting the forests near their mines, authorized imports under certain conditions. Even then, the company could ship only in British vessels and only to Great Britain. Despite its ambitions, the American company could not escape the confines of its time. In a few countries, such as Great Britain and the Netherlands, international trade directly touched the lives of many citizens in the age of mercantilism, not always for the better. The innovations in spinning that helped British cloth conquer the global market in the late 1700s dramatically reduced labor costs, impoverishing thousands of English villagers who had earned part of their incomes at the spinning wheel. When Parliament dealt with the strains of war with France by prohibiting banks from redeeming paper money with gold in 1797, the credit crunch in Great Britain caused a recession in the United States. But most countries, from China and Japan to Russia and the vast Ottoman Empire, had weak international economic ties. The vast majority of the world's population lived from subsistence farming, tenuously connected to the cash economy. Those remote from ports and major trade routes hardly felt the effects of international commodity flows and foreign loans. The work of British economist Angus Maddison, the foremost historian of economic growth, offers a sense of scale. Maddison's estimate of international trade in 1813 was less than 1/2000th the volume in 2013. It would take three innovations to make globalization possible: the oceanic steamship, the telegraph cable, and some dramatically different ideas about international trade. All three came about with the unanticipated rise of capitalism. Chapter 2. The First Globalization. It may have been no coincidence that the man whose thinking opened the way to globalization was himself a product of it. David Ricardo was a descendant of Sephardic Jews. His father's family, originally from Portugal, fled the Inquisition sometime in the early 1500s, found a haven in Italy, and then moved to Amsterdam, a burgeoning financial center, around 1662. Abraham Ricardo emigrated from Amsterdam to London in 1760 and married Abigail Del Val, whose family had arrived in London shortly after Jews were permitted to live openly in England in 1656. Her surname points to roots in Spain. By the time David, the third of at least 17 children, was born in 1772, Abraham had become a British citizen and had grown wealthy trading stocks and bonds. He sent David off to Amsterdam at age 11 for 2 years of schooling before bringing him home to learn the family business. David Ricardo excelled in finance in his own right, becoming a prominent subscriber to government loans and joining the committee of proprietors of the stock exchange. He was a worldly man, conversant in several languages, and steeped in the intellectual debates of his day. Foreign trade was among the most prominent topics, and Ricardo had unorthodox views. They became public in 1815, when he criticized proposed duties on grain imports, set out in legislation known as the Corn Laws, with the radical assertion that protecting Britain's farmers from foreign competition was unwise. It would be better, he said, to let in imports so grain prices would fall. As landowners' profits fell, they would shift their capital into the manufacturing sector. When that occurred, Ricardo wrote, Manufactured products could be exported to buy more grain than Great Britain could grow if it tried to be self-sufficient, making both the landowners and the country better off. 2 years later, Ricardo developed.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.